Today's video is going to be about the Scythians, a people generally pretty much unknown nowadays, unknown to archaeology as well as any other science, because it's been lost in time, like so much of human history, where there are no remnants left behind to intrigue people. But curiously, humans had this habit of burying things. And when you start to see a great many things buried in one particular area, your curiosity gets aroused, which is the case with the Scythians. Now, we had some nameless hints because of Herodotus and his histories, but so many of these early cultures were pre-literate, shall we say, and all they left behind were artifacts, no records, such as written down in bone script or some other ancient text. People carved in stones, but 1,000 years along and they can't be deciphered. Unless you can find something magical thing to give you half a clue, like the Rosetta Stone. In any case, today we're talking about the Scythians, as written up by Sir Barrington Windsor Cunliffe, who wrote a book about them in, I believe, 2019. The Scythians, nomad warriors of the steppes. One thing nice about the Kurgans, their burial mounds for the Scythians, is that they were embedded into permafrost, which has a habit of preserving things year-round. So if you can find an intact Kurgan, you will find many things that are quite startling, including mummies. Now, the Scythians were known to the ancient Greeks and considered one of the preeminent of the pagan cultures. They were a nomadic Asiatic culture, which of course gave rise to the Mongols and the Huns and so on. And they stretched from the Altair Mountains in the far reaches of China all the way to the Pontic Plains in Hungary, following a sea of a ribbon of grass, which is what their horses and their flocks needed. And they raised all kinds of creatures, sheep, goats, perhaps some cattle, although that's not quite certain. And the inevitable, the wondrous horse. They were among the first to have horses. Now, you're not supposed to imagine by horses Mustangs and Frisians and thoroughbreds, modern horses. You will find Przewalski horses, more primitive type of equus, more like sturdy, stout ponies. So these were also the horse lords, as mentioned in Herodotus, who numbered their herds in thousands. It might be a little exaggeration, but modern archaeologists do tend to bear out they had a great many of them, if not thousands, certainly hundreds. Many of the horses, of course, and retainers would be slaughtered or sacrificed and put into the kurgans as perhaps servants in the afterlife, you know, much like the ancient Egyptians put various pictorial representations of people who would help in the afterlife. The land they have inhabited was very fragile because the thin layer that supported the grass was above permafrost. So in the temperature, the weather fluctuated greatly during the Bronze Age. And anytime the weather got bad, turned cold, turned too dry, turned too wet, whole groups would migrate. And they migrated to the warmer south and the more grass-friendly west, which is why everybody kept going to the west, following the ribbon of grass across the steppes. So this made the building of permanent settlements difficulty, hence the constant nomadism and the fact that you had to go in pursuit of food, land, and raiding opportunities, much like the Vikings in a later age. Scythians could be identified by not only the good grave goods, the art, the artifacts, but also by their tattoos. They were definitely into tattoos, as has been demonstrated by actual mummies, remnants of skin, line drawings by the archaeologists, who of course record everything from the time of Peter the Great onward. But other than this, all we have is hearsay from the people they traded with, raided, or otherwise displaced. Now, Professor Sir Barrington Windsor Cunliffe wrote a rather dry book about it, but it'll tell you almost everything you might want to know. Plus, he's also given several YouTube presentations that you can look up as you might wish to. Now, I find the subject interesting, because there's always something fascinating about the unknown, the different, especially so when the clash is between two completely different cultures. You have the orderly, civilized, city-building Greeks who wrote everything they possibly could write on any topic, any subject, blah, 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 very, very chatty bunch. And yet you have these people coming by very flamboyant, nomadic, tumultuous warriors that ebb and flow through time and space. Some days they're here, some days they're not. Yeah, it's all lends a little excitement to an otherwise drab existence, perhaps. But eventually they just disappear. They just are displaced by other tribes. They settle down here and there. They come into contact. Their culture is gradually eroded. And they just disappear. Until you can't tell a Scythian from Samaritan. Now, Sir Barrington also wrote about the other cultures. In 2020, he wrote about the Celts. And in 2021, he wrote about the Bretons and the Britons. Because, like most other subjects, one has to keep up. And with new data, especially DNA coming along, there's further research to be done. So you have to keep up with the science of archaeology and ethnography, you know, ethics and so on. You have to keep up with the different ethnicities as we delve further and further. All very interesting. And you can find these books anywhere online. So I recommend them to anyone who's actually interested in the human story, the history of humans, and then the question of civilization and who came before others. Now, in Sir Barrington's book, The Celts, he also tells you something in the first section of the first chapter. He also tells you a bit of a cautionary tale. How much what you're told in archaeology and how archaeology is expressed and presented to you can serve political purposes. And he cautions us to try to see behind any sort of nonsense, as he calls it. Because the present will always cloud the past. And if you want to see the past clearly, you have to pay closer attention and beware inserting your own biases into the information before you. I hope this helps. Thank you for watching, and please do come again.